Our inspirational speaker today is certainly inspirational. At the age of 10, we have down here Gene, but it's Johannes Michalski. Sorry, I'm pretty bad. Climbed a utility pole together with friends and sustained such severe burn injuries that both his arms had to be amputated. Soon afterwards, he learned to write and paint, holding a pen between his teeth. He perfected his skills and studied at the Royal Academy of Fine Arts in Brussels. In 1960, he became a full member of the AMPFA. Today, Johannes, with great emphasis on the brushwork. Among his favorite motifs are landscapes, the sea, flowers. His works have won him numerous awards and distinctions and have repeatedly been mentioned in press reports and on television. His paintings have been exhibited in Brussels and in many other cities around the globe, and now here at the Courtyard by Marriott. Not only is Johannes inspirational, but he is brilliant. He's a friend to everyone who meets him. Help me in welcoming Johannes. I won't mess up your name again.
Can you hear me? Like she said, my name is Johannes, or it means John the Baptist. And Michalski is son of Michael. So I got two patrons. So you go realize that I have an accent, and people say, how come you have an accent? Because I tell them I'm from outer space. I'm a permanent resident alien. And I got my green card. So yes, I am a mud artist painter for 45 years. I belong to the Association of Mud and Foot Artist Painters in all the world, who are 45 countries. Mm-hmm. 45 countries. They paint with a brush in the mouth or with their foot. And I want to present my friend here, Nancy Baldwin. She is a 24/7 taking care of me every day. And she's a wonderful lady. So yeah, I traveled a lot in a lot of countries. I had a few sessions in St. George in schools for kids, and bringing my painting and talk to the kids. And one kid said, "You are a fake. Your arms are behind your jacket." So I took my jacket off, and he goes, "You're not a fake at all." So he was red in his face. And I did a lot of school, all in St. George, Santa Clara, all around, yeah.
All the different schools.
All different schools in St. George. Elementary.
Middle school.
Middle school.
High school.
High school. And even college. And even bad boys and bad girls. I think it's called the Eagle Nest in St. George somewhere.
There's a few of them.
But they were wonderful. They liked it all. So what can I tell else? Recently, 2 years ago, I had a phone call in my studio, and when I got there from my living room to the studio, the telephone hung up. So I got back, and then it ringed again. So I have a lot of patience. So I got back, and it stopped again. So third time, it was getting dark, and I had a phone call. have a duophone that I can answer. And I put the light on and I fell on hard floor. And I broke my hip at three places, my right hip. So I've been operated on it and taking to collab. And I've been there for 8 months to have rehab. But then with all 45 years of bending down and going yes and no, they had to operate on my neck. So they put four vertebrae out
and four nerves.
That's why I have that neck brace on. So, and I have to still keep smiling. So one kid in school said, "Oh, I cannot do what you are doing." I said, "If I can do it, you can do it better. It's all in your mind. And if you can dream it, you can realize it." So I have a book that I read in French because I know five languages, believe it or not. Yeah, French, Dutch, German, and English, and Spanish. Is that enough for America? Yeah, okay. So, yeah, I invited Nancy and her granddaughter to go to Las Vegas to see the show. And I have to tell you, before this, we were with the motorhome to
Mesa,
Arizona. And I had a dream because I love dolphins. I paint dolphins. And I wanted to kiss a dolphin. And I did. Not two times.
One time.
One time, two times. Five times. Because he came back. I thought he was in love with me. I don't know if it was a female or a male.
I don't know.
So, do you want to say something, Nancy?
No, you keep talking.
Well, you said 45 hours. I don't know.
No, I said 45 minutes.
45 minutes?
Yeah.
I'm done.
No, you're not done. You're not done.
Well, I'm telling you, I'm Polish. And that's why my name is Michalski. It means son of Michael, the archangel. And I have a Polish joke. You know what they say about Polish?
This is one he's made up.
You always need Polish in your house to make it shiny. Well, I am in this wheelchair and...
But what are your aspirations? What do you want to do? You've been in the wheelchair now for 3 years. It's time to get out.
Time to walk. And I got the rehab at the summit. I go...
It's not rehab, workout.
Workout, yeah. I have swimming. And when I'm in the water, I feel so light, I can walk. But once I come out, is the attraction going and the pain is there. So I fall on my hip, on my other hip in collab, twice out of bed at night. So I have pain.
Why did you do that? Why were you able to fall out of your bed? That's a rehab place. Why were you falling out of your bed?
Well, I asked him to put a border on the side and they said it's against the, it is against the law. But they find finally some little border, so...
A towel.
What do you call it?
A towel.
A towel?
Uh-huh. They rolled up a towel and put it on there.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It's against the law for people who have that, if they have arms. But if they don't have arms, then they have no control. When they're going to go out there. So,
and, Sorry.
Missed up.
Missed up.
Yeah.
talk you a little bit about my accident. I was 10 years old, and my mother had a cafe, and I had to empty the bottles of beer. And so my brother got on the door and said, "Where are you going, Antoine?" He said, "To the soccer game." "So I can go with you?" "No, no, you have to help mom." So I was mad. And then,
a little radical.
And then came some kids, my friends passed by. "Where are you going?" "Oh, to the soccer game." "Come on," I say, "I can't."
He's a little rebel.
Darn it.
Darn it.
The window was open, was a gliding window. And I put one foot around and look at my mom. Oh, she was there. And I run so fast I can't. And I follow the kids.
Was she looking?
No. And so we arrived at the soccer game. And we were five kids. And one had a whistle. And so he was whistling every time the referee was whistling. And it was bothering the game. So they kicked us out of the football soccer game.
Rowdy.
Yeah, soccer game. So we saw electric pole, and we had one little bossy guy, and he said, "The first of the pole is the strongest." And we ran, and I was the first, and he was under me, and I climbed higher. And after a quarter of an hour, he was tired to watch the soccer game. "Let's go, guys. Let's go home." I say, "No, I'm staying here. My brothers are at the soccer game." And I say, "If I wait after him, I go be probably punished less because he defended me all the time." My brother is he's 84 now. I'm 80. Can you believe that? Time passed by very
like 52,
fast.
52, right?
Yeah.
52.
And so I saw those wires, and he was going mad and going under me and tell me that he go take me down. And I was care of Hyde, and I said, "There are some wires there." I put my arm around it, and so I had 11,000 volt to my arms, to my heart, to the other side, and they were totally burned. And they had a factory 50 feet from the electricity pole and had a stop. So I fell 45 feet down on the floor. My head was open, my brain came out of my head. And they saw a flash on the soccer game and they stopped it. And they took me to the hospital. So I have to tell you, this is all in a book that I read in French, and then it was translated in English, and it's called "With a Brush in the Mouth," and it's for sale, and you're gonna spend that much money on it. It's $20 and 15 cents. I don't want to tell the joke. 15 cents is for the St. Jude Hospital in Salt Lake, for the kids who have cancer.
But during the election, what did we tell? What was the joke you told? During the election. 15 cents for the St. Jude's Hospital, for the St. Jude's children.
Yeah, but we give, Nancy gives some, and I give some more than that. But every 15 cents we put in a vase, and it is, at the long run, they get more.
This man pays $3,500 a month to Primary Children's Hospital as well as St. Jude's. Every month, because I know, because it's debited out of his account. Now, what was the cheery part that you said during the election? What was that? What was the 15 cents for?
That
funny part.
Oh, I cannot tell you that.
You can't. We don't care. We don't care.
He's not president anymore.
We don't care.
It was for Obama to buy toilet paper to wipe his butter.
And I talked you into saying butt. What did you say? I talked you into saying butt because this is St. George, and this is usually Mormon Mormon thing. What did you say? You're not Mormon.
I'm not Mormon.
So what did you say?
I like all the Mormon.
I know. What did you say?
What?
What did you call it? To wipe his... Come on.
But.
What did you say, Johannes? Look at these people. They don't care. They're not judging. Who did you say?
Yeah, wipe his ass off.
So, no, I'm not American, so.
So you can say
give
that.
Me the microphone.
Oh. I watched last night our new president.
Oh no, that was
Donald
so
Trump.
Sorry, guys.
It's okay, and I'm not like I'm an alien. So, and I think from my heart. And his heart that he's going to be a good, good president of America.
Okay, Johannes, so what did you used to think when I brought home People magazine with Trump on it?
What's her name again?
Hillary.
Hillary.
Uh-huh.
What? No.
Hillary Clinton.
What about?
What did you usually think? Let's not name names. Let's say, what did you usually think when I brought home Trump with when people's name, you know, People's magazine? You said, get that out of here? Why? Why?
Well, I think we live on all the same planet, and we are all the same blood, like Trump said last night, and we have to go together, Democrats of Republicans, we all human beings, and I hope
that. And you forget.
And
for him saying that, remember what he said.
What he said.
He said about the disabled people.
No, I know.
Go ahead.
Yeah, he likes the veterans. He likes the disabled. He wants to do a lot of things. The what?
Painting. Like, they want to know about your painting.
My painting?
And,
well,
open for
I don't even have seen them. What are they? Is there a Native American?
Yes. Yeah. You have your guest.
Oh. That is, I like Native Americans. Is their country first. And this is a dancing Cheyenne. He's dancing in the moonshine. And maybe it's Kayenta, where I live for 10 years. So, ballerina, she's ready to go to her ballet, and then there's a water mill there, and it's snowing, but snow is not white, it has different colors. So I express myself in there. The other one, I've been to India.
It's the Taj Mahal right there.
It's called the Taj Mahal. It's a mausoleum of a Maharaji, and he made that for her because she had too many kids. So she died, and this is all made of white marble, and it's one of the wonders of the world, of this planet. I'm walking.
My legs. It's okay.
And then there is a famous artist, you know him. They call him the Duke, but I call him John Wayne.
Okay.
And this is a lighthouse with the snow. And like you noticed, the lighthouse melted the snow.
So when you see
this are just a few of my hundreds and hundreds of paintings.
Yeah.
So what the association does, they reproduce the original painting on postcards and calendars, and they're selling to the public in all the world. We have all those artists, you know, from China to America, yeah, even.
Mm-hmm.
So I hope you have a wonderful evening.
And let them know what made you feel like you could go on when you were not going on? You were really, really down in the dumps. What happened when you worked at the hospital? Can you tell them about that young boy?
No, but when you are disabled like me, and I worked in a hospital for 4.5 years, I have seen paraplegics. I had artificial arms, and I was selling stamps and cigarettes and a lot of and tickets for the personnel to have dinners. And I saw a guy coming in, and he was blind. And he came for to have prostheses for to walk his dog, his shepherd dog. And I said, you think you're the only one like that? Look at him, he's in the dark all the day. And he wants to have some help with his dog. That was wonderful for me. Okay, I think I'm done.
Yeah.
Are you have any questions?
Do you want to bring your
sure,
I'll see him much better. Anybody have any questions?
Nina? This is my friend.
I always have a question.
Nina.
She always has a friend. Or she always has a friend.
Nina put an article in a magazine too of me. Thank you, Nina.
I want to know how you are able to do such precise painting. I mean, the pictures are absolutely gorgeous. And then, are they in any of the art studios? Do you sell them? Do you put them on display at different places?
A lot of the paintings are taken with photos. We're taking photos. And then I lock myself up in my studio with some soft music, classic, and then I paint. I have to draw first the drawing on the canvas, and I have a palette on the side, and that's why the bending goes up and down, and the turpentine cleaning. And it was terrible before because they had that turpentine smell, and after they created a turpentine, it's called odorless turpentine, and that was much better. Yeah, it takes a lot of work and concentration.
How much time?
Like the Taj Mahal, it took me 3 weeks to 1 month to make just the drawing of it. And it's in my book. And then the painting itself took me probably 2 months. I'm working on it every day, every day.
And why so long? What do you have to do in order to get precise? What do you do when you paint, when you draw? Do you just do it like I do it, just like that?
No.
Okay, how do you do it?
You do it first too well.
What do you do? Let them know that's what they're asking. They're asking, what?
With all my love and my heart.
And you take a deep breath.
And every stroke I do, I hold my breath in.
Every stroke.
Every stroke. And you can look at the Taj Mahal very short by, and people. I have a gallery down at the for Pierce Drive downstairs, and people. I cannot go down now because of my wheelchair. And so they come, they go and take 15 minutes, and then they come up and say, amazing. Say, thank you very much. I think it is.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Where are they displayed at?
In his basement. He has an actual a gallery down there.
It's called the Palette Art Gallery. Yeah, it's in Bloomington Hill, closer to God I am. And it's there, and everybody can come see it. Yeah, they are for sale.
Yeah, you know, being in St. George.
And just being up in the time that I have a big role for you now, what I see with him is it's very hard for him to release a painting because they're priceless. Because in St. George, as wonderful as we are here, the doctors here did not even ask him what he did for a living. And when he had his been painting for 48 years, and he had to have his neck operated on, and they fused it, which caused him to have more mobility in his neck. Now, he has more mobility in his neck than he has had hyperspectrums before he couldn't move. But with therapy, so now he's able to really do a signature and things like that.
We did a jury of trees in the mesquite, and then we did what woman wants.
And what do you want?
They wanted me.
How did you come to realize that you could do this, that you had this ability?
When I was in the cafe with my mother had, was a waitress there. After my accident, I was just doing nothing. And I had my mother give me a pencil in my brush, and I tried to draw like a house with a tree and a walkway. And a guy came and he said, "You have to do it like this." And he showed me. Oh, I said, "That's how you do a house." Okay. And I learned. And then I've been institutionalized. And that's why I had to go with non-disabled kids, only me, to learn with a pen to make A's and B's, pages and pages and pages, and finally write. And that was in Dutch. That's why I speak Dutch. And I came out of school, and then I had that thing in the hospital 4.5 years for my readaptation for my prosthesis. And I worked there. And so after my mother received those postcards in the mailbox, and she wrote to the founder and director of the association, whose name is Eric Stegman, and he created that little by little, and we have 54, maybe 100, 200 artists in all the world. Yeah.
About
178. 178. She knows more than I am.
I read it.
Yeah. So, and when you, I don't know, I saw 2,000. 300 and something books, and I have $20.15, and I have a more deluxe book, and it's $30.15. You have to pay for the gold.
Johannes,
yeah.
Your art is absolutely amazing. I mean, for someone with arms, it's amazing. It's
thanks.
Fantastic. A lot of artists will do the same type of paintings. Yours is so diversified. You know, you were talking about when you fell, and you said your head cracked open, and your brain literally was outside your skull. So my question, I guess, is before your accident, were you creative? Did you have that creative side?
No, my mother always asked me, "What do you want to do when you grow up?" I say, "I want to be a pianist or a violinist," because my father was a violinist.
So you said you were institutionalized because your parents really couldn't take care of you, is that?
No, at that time in 1947, they didn't want any guy like me in the school.
Okay. They were very adamant that with him it was...
it was not proper, or it was not something for him to be in a regular school and play soccer. He played soccer when he was he loved playing soccer, and when I first came in contact with Johannes Michalski, he had legs that were God was gardening and living outside. And but in that time, he was not allowed to regular school because of his disability. Mm-hmm. And for all those who are here tonight, what I'd like to remind you of is these people are disabled. They're not handicapped. They're disabled.
Oh, I have to tell you that story about that. I had a reporter who was coming to Ramona and interviewing me, and they had cameras, and he was going on and on, what else can you do with your handicap, Johannes? And I said, what? Stop the camera, please. No more.
He's pretty adamant.
I go tell you, I'm not, you know what, they give that on horses, handicap.
And go.
And I'm not a,
I'm not handicapped.
I'm not handicapped. I'm not a horse. I'm a human being. So, and we try to abolish all that where it's handicapped. We still have some in front of the hospital, and I'm fighting for Nancy and I. We go to the receptionist. We have to take that off, put disabled or the little wheelchair. But we are all disabled and able to. I think I passed my 45 minutes.
No. Actually, you did really well.
What's on your watch?
What's on my watch? What's in your wallet, buddy?
Does anybody else have any other questions?
This is in French.
No, no. C'est mon ami. I want to put in a plug for the book.
He bought the book, too.
I bought the book. I read the book. We have forgotten the Great War. And having lived in Belgium myself, and he's mon ami.
Friend.
Nous parlons en français.
You speak French.
De temps en temps.
I'm translating.
The book will deepen your understanding of the suffering of the European people at that time. I can't tell you. It's not just a book about a guy that paints with his brush in his mouth. It's about his life. His mother, unbelievable person. The suffering of the children in World War II. I've been on those battlefields. I can't tell you how it makes me feel. And how I respect and love the people of Belgium. And they love America. You go into the little towns in Belgium, and they have a little place, and they have the flags of the countries that liberated them twice. And the flag of the United States of America flies along with the French flag, the Union Jack, and so on. Your heart just goes out. Many of those towns had to be liberated twice, World War I and World War II, by the same Allied forces. Anyway, he's a great guy. His book is wonderful.
Merci, mon ami.
Buy the book. You will not be disappointed.
Thank you, my friend.
Thank you.
Mon ami.
Johannes, thank you very much.
My pleasure.
You are an amazing man.
My pleasure.
Nancy, thank you so much for sharing with us.